Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message, and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues a series entitled, America in Turmoil. Pastor John started teaching about the Antichrist in the 1970s, but the technology just wasn't there to support the beast system. A lot has changed in 50 years. America is now at the tipping point that the next president could voluntarily surrender our sovereignty to Satan's global federation. The political stage is set, and civil unrest is being orchestrated to destabilize our nation. The solution is not to take up arms and fight these ungodly people. This is a battle that must be fought with spiritual weapons. Only through the power of the Holy Spirit can we convince people to stand for biblical principles and cast their votes for candidates who are willing to uphold the teachings of Jesus. This message is entitled, Order Out of Chaos. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm going to be preaching today on Order Out of Chaos. And this is my series, America in Turmoil. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you. I'm going to praise you right now for giving me an anointing as I'm going to be preaching this message today, Lord. And I just ask you right now, I rebuke every demonic force that is trying to mess with me, and I shall have no problems whatsoever. And I thank you now for the anointing upon myself and upon everyone that watches or listens to it, this message. And this I ask in Jesus' name, amen and amen. I'm going to do a historic review here. And as I was preparing this message, I realized that I have lived through a development that's been fast, furious, compared to years before. And I got these points here that I would just mention to you now. So in 1965, when I came back to Christ, we had a black and white television set in our home. We had a radio and we had a telephone. That was it. There was no TSA screening at the airports. You could go to an airport. No one bothered you. There was no policeman outside or policeman inside or guards. You just walked in, did what you want to, go to the all the way in the terminal to greet people when they come in or when they were leaving. And if you went to a courthouse or any federal or state buildings, there was no security. No one met you at the door and asked you, do you have a knife on you? Do you have this and that? You just walked in and there was not a problem. Everybody was nice. There was no barcodes. And my wife was working for some years as what they call a, she worked in the back room, and she would put stickers, the price on products, and put them out. And so that's a whole group of people that were working and putting price tags on each item in the stores. We did not even know what a barcode was. We never heard of them. And if you want to open a checking account, your bank account, whatever it is, it was very simple. No one asked you, you know, are you a terrorist? Are you with this or that? You just walked into the bank. They were happy to have you. And all you had to do was to show your driver's license, tell them that's where I live, and your account was opened up, and it was, life was easy. It was nice. You could move around. Now, they had problems in the inner cities, like in Los Angeles and New York, and there were problems there. But in generality, back in 1965, it was very nice to live, people are nice to one another, polite. Now, I'm talking about the slippery slope. So, I started preaching on the Antichrist back in the 1970s, and we were simply saying in a month that I told people, you know, this is far in the future. We don't have the technology right now. So the barcode came into being in 1973 with a uniform grocery product code. And when we saw that, there were books written, The Mark of the Beast and so on. And the barcode was very convenient for the retail stores and people living today. You know, there are times I go to in a store and I'm looking for a price. You don't find prices where the items are. You have to go and have it checked out and so on. By 1969, it was coming in city to access television program through a coaxial cable system. And by 1976, the cable providers had begun to use satellites for transmission, and the number of people purchased large diameter satellite dishes that sat on the ground. I remember my brother Peter. He had bought a satellite dish. He was a proud owner of that. So I traveled down. He lived in the Santa Rosa area at that time. And I remember that dish sitting in his backyard. It was about 8 feet diameter, a huge one. And it was sitting there and pointing up into the sky. And it was expensive. And they said, but that you have to have that big of a dish in order to get programming coming down from the satellites. We had television antennas. I mean, you know, they were like trees. Today, a dish is about maybe 12 inches diameter, and the technology has just gone wild. In 1977, the personal computer was introduced, but it really didn't take off until in the 1990s. The pager was introduced in 1962, and you folks that are born after 1980, you don't even know what a pager is. That was top of the line by the 1980s. Anyone that had somebody, a businessman, that had a pager. And the way it worked was simply this. Had a telephone number to it. These were the days you had telephone booths outside everywhere. And so you got your pager. Beep, 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 would beep, vibrate, and you were looking for where's the nearest telephone booth, and you go and call the number that showed up on a pager. We thought that was high tech. Man, look at the communication we can have. So the pager, usually you have doctors today and emergency responders use it because if a system breaks down, they still like to have that. But the pager simply disappeared out in oblivion. The Intel Corporation introduced its first microchip in 1971. And it is common for animals to be microchipped today, allowing them to be tracked remotely if they are missing. And also there's a lot of people today, and I spoke about this some time ago, that are being microchipped, and particularly in Sweden, where they have different mass transit, and they simply say this, if you put a chip in, you never have to buy a ticket, you just get on a train, wave your hand, and you know, they will bill you later. It's similar to what we have in the San Francisco Bay Area, where you got a transponder in your car, and you drive through the bridges, and you don't have to stop, and then they just charge you later on. Now, the cell phone came on the market in 1973, but it was not until 1983 that the viable system was created. I remember My parents simply said, son, we're going to buy you a cell phone because we care for you and we want you to be able to call. Well, the cell phone was about that wide. It was in a bag, and it weighed probably about 5 or 6 pounds. Battery was most of it. It had, you know, a receiver you picked up and talked to. And I had it in my front seat, laying there, plugged in, you know, electrically to my car. And I thought, you know, wow, what a technology. Where is this going? And, but a cell phone at that time was extremely expensive. I remember you got a bill, a couple of $100. So we didn't use the cell phone a lot because it was very, very expensive. Now, you have smartphones. I still got a flip phone. I don't want to go to the smartphones. I don't need them. And you can retrieve voicemails, send text, check email, take pictures, shoot videos. And you can do a lot of things on your smartphones. But it hasn't been around that long. The internet did not really take off until 1990. When it went from being just a national system in the United States to the World Wide Web. So I was born in Stone Age. We didn't have a whole lot. And today, the technology is totally different. The latest development of DNA testing, along with a voice and face recognition, have completed the technology that Satan requires to install the Antichrist. If you go to China today, you will find that at all railroad stations, airport terminals, stores, everywhere are cameras. And they are hooked up to a computer system. And you have a facial recognition. If you're a criminal in China, you are being picked up on a camera, they recognize you, and they know exactly where you are, and they can pick you up. So what I thought that would happen in a distant future, maybe some 200 years later, it only took 50 years from 1970 up to now to get to where we are, that today the technology will support the Antichrist. I want to turn very quickly here to Revelation 13. That's Revelation chapter 13. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 5. And there was given to him, that's the Antichrist, the mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given to him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and them that dwell in heaven. It was given to him to make war with the saints, to overcome them, and the power was given him over all kingdoms and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain for the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. Now, Jesus simply told the Apostle John, this is going to be a world wide system. I call it the World Federation. In the same chapter, though, we got the false prophet, and he says here in verse number 15, he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond to receive a mark in their right hand with their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had a mark or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Today, 2020, in the United States, if you walk into a bank and you want to do some transaction, the first thing they ask you is, what's your social security number? If you want to buy a car, you're going to have a social security number. If you're going to buy a house, you're going to have a social security number. It doesn't matter where you go today in the United States, you have to have a number. In Europe, they even gone even further than that. And so they now have it. You can be chipped with your personal number, what they call person number. Or you can have it simply on a smart card, and would you use that to buy and sell with. The technology is here. So everything now in Revelation chapter 13 can now be supported by the current technology we have today. It's here. They don't have to do any more. It's just to implement it. I want to talk to you about shock troops here. Now, Satan cannot erect his global federation without the United States. United States is the biggest power in the world. President Trump, the Republican Party, and the 63 million Americans against globalism who voted for Trump must be removed. It is not enough to elect Joe Biden, who incidentally is showing increasing signs of dementia. They must create chaos to destabilize our nation. No people are going to submit to a stupid world government unless there is chaos. If you have employment, everybody's working, the economy is moving, everything is fine, everybody's having a good time, no one is going to want to say, let's start a revolution. You got to destroy the economy, you got to cause all kind of chaos, and then you will be able to get a number of people that would work with you. Let's look upon Proverbs 25:5. That's Proverbs 25:5. I'm going to read just a couple of verses here. Proverbs 25, verse number 5. And if I get to 25, there we go. Take away the wicked from before the king, and his throne shall be established in righteousness. Think for a moment now. Take away the wicked from before the king. Who are they? The advisors, the politicians. Remove the wicked ones, and the throne is established in righteousness. When President Trump came into office, he began to roll back the abortion, Planned Parenthood. He rolled back regulations. For example, like you have, you know, a certain little frog. If it lives on a pond, if you got a pond on your property, you got a frog there, you can't touch that area because you got to protect that little frog. Or birds, or whatever it is. And then if you look in Proverbs 29, and we look in verses 2, we read this. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked bears rule, the people mourn. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked bear rule, the people mourn. And then verse number 12 in the same chapter. If a ruler hearken to lies, all his servants are wicked. This pretty much describes our political leaders today. And lies is basically what they are using. Now, I want to give you some statistics. If you want to write this down, I want to give you some statistics. In the election 2016, 65 million people voted for Hillary, which is 52% of the voters. 65 million voted for Hillary, 52% of the entire voting base. 63 million voted for Trump. He got 50.4%. That's 50.4%. That means we got a razor thin difference here. Why did President Trump win when he got less votes? Because we had the Electoral College. And so the founders of this country simply said this: it's going to be some big states, like in those days you had New York, and we don't want the big states to dominate. So each state will have X number of people for the Electoral College. So when you have a presidential election, it is not the popular vote, but it is simply so that small states have just about as much power as a big state per capita. So that's the reason that Hillary lost. She carried California, he carried New York and some of the bigger states, but President Trump carried a lot of other smaller states, and that's how he got in. Now, here's the thing that most people don't think about. We looked up the death rate in the state of in the United States. This has nothing to do with the COVID-19. This is a regular death rate in the United States. So the death rate in the United States is 2.8 million people die every year. So in 4 years, from 2016 to 2020, 11.2 million Americans have died. That means 11.2 million voters have died that voted in 2016. They are not around for 2020. That means we have brought in 11 million new voters, younger voters. And the base for President Trump were older people, conservative people. He did not carry the big cities. He did not carry the younger people because they had their hearts changed. This means that when we have the election 2020, it's going to be a miracle to get Trump reelected because we have lost 11.2 million people. We have a younger generation coming in, which basically is not conservative. And that means that the voter base for the Republican Party has shrunk, and the voter base for the Democrats have increased. It's going to take a miracle of God. I want to take you right now to the Jeremiah. This is the bonus scripture. So Jeremiah chapter 44, Jeremiah chapter 44, and what I'm going to say right now might shock some of you, but let me say it anyway. most people that are voting for the Democratic Party are demon possessed. Nancy Pelosi, Chuck Schumer, Nadler, and a number of others are demon possessed. They've been taken over by evil spirits, and they are doing the bidding of the Father, the devil. There was a time in Israel, just before the Babylonians, actually after the Babylonians had taken over Jerusalem, and there was a remnant of the army, the Israeli army, and people, probably in the neighborhood of 100,000 people were left over. And they killed the governor that the Babylonians had put in there. He was a Jewish man. They killed him. And they went to Egypt. Now, Jeremiah had simply said, if you go to Egypt, you're all going to die. God is going to visit you. He doesn't want you in Egypt. Sword, famine, pestilence. And they simply said, we don't care. We're going to go. Here's what I'm telling you. The leadership at that time, military, political, men, women, and children, were demonized. They simply could not think properly. They had become demonized, and they were hell-bent on going to Egypt, and they did. In verse number 15 of Jeremiah 44, I want us to read here the response of these people. Then all the men which knew that their wives had burned incense unto other gods, and all the women that stood by, a great multitude, even all the people that dwelt in the land of Egypt, in Pathros, answered Jeremiah, saying, as for the word that you have spoken unto us in the name of the Lord, we will not hearken unto you. Let me read that verse again. As for the word that you have spoken to us in the name of the Lord, we will not hearken unto you. But we will certainly do whatsoever things go forth out of our own mouth, to burn incense unto the Queen of Heaven, to pour our drink offering to her, as we have done, we and our fathers, our kings and our princes, in the cities of Judah, in the streets of Jerusalem. For then had we plenty of victuals, food, and we were well and saw no evil. But since we left off to burn incense to the Queen of Heaven, and to pour our drink offerings unto her, we have wanted all things, have been consumed by the sword and by the famine. And when we burned incense to the Queen of Heaven and poured out drink offerings unto her, did we make her cakes to worship her and pour our drink offerings unto her without amen? Then Jeremiah said unto the people, to the men and to the women, to all the people which had given him that answer, saying, the incense that you burn in the city of Judah, the streets of Jerusalem, you and your fathers, your kings, and your princes, and the people of the land, did not the Lord remember them, and came it not into his mind? So that the Lord could no longer bear because of evil of your doings, and because of the abominations which you have committed, therefore in your land, a desolation, an astonishment, and a curse, without inhabitant, as at this day. And then verse number 27. Behold, I will watch over them for evil and not for good, and all the men of Judah that are in the land of Egypt shall be consumed by the sword, by the famine, until there be an end of them. Through archaeology and history, we know that the hundreds of thousands of Jews had fled into Egypt. They all died. The Babylonians sent an army down to Egypt, wiped out the Egyptian king, and simply slaughtered the Jews that were there. They died. That's how much Satan hates God's people. The same hate you see today in the streets. It is not just against whites or blacks. This is a war between Satan's people and God's people. Let me talk about Antifa for a few moments here. Now, there are more than Antifa here in this country. And to those of you that are watching me, you got to understand that I lived in Europe. I've been traveling in Europe. I had crusades. And I have met with a number of people. I've seen revolutions. I remember in Sweden how it was there and so on. And so the people you see in the streets, they are, what you call it, dummies. They are the shock troops, the brown shirts, the communists. And they don't really have an agenda. Their job is to tear things up, do destruction, break down the system so that law and order is broken down, so we cannot hold property, you can't drive a car, you can't do nothing. Chaos. This is what that's their job. And let me just read to you here what I had here on page number 2 of my outline. A minister supporter sent me a copy of what purports to be an Antifa street manual, which I have attached again here. We had it last week. When compared to the instruction given to communist revolutionaries, it reminded me of what the Illuminati started in 1776 and subsequently carried out in France a few years later. These instructions are also similar to the actions of Hitler's brown shirts in 1930. What you see on the streets today is nothing new. It's the same old program, an Illuminati program. Now, the main points they have is simply this. They want to take away white privilege. They call white men CIS, which means it's a white man that has remained a man. He had not questioned, am I a man or am I a woman? Now, I'm very happy. I managed to get 80 years in on this earth, and I have never in my life, not one time, thought, maybe I am a woman. Never even entered into my mind. The Antifa hates people like me. So they simply want to take away white privilege. They want to create a culture of tolerance, which means intolerance. They want to crash the borders. They want to control the media. They believe what they say or you will be fired. Have you noticed this now? For example, we had, you know, Uncle Ben's cereal or whatever it was, or some kind of stuff. We had a number of different things we had over the years, an Eskimo pie. And now they're saying, no, we got to change the names of those because, you know, they are racial. We can't have that. So a lot of things are going to be destroyed because they simply want you to conform. They want socialization. They want to socialize capital. They don't want you to work and get a paycheck. If you really love socialism, there are two countries I can send you to. Be glad to send you there. First, I can send you to Sweden. And in Sweden, you pay 50% income tax. So that goes 50% of what you earn. Then when you go out shopping, they have a 25% sales tax. On top of that, you have tax on your cars, you have tax on your gasoline. And if you want to buy firewood, there is tax on buying firewood. Matter of fact, you have more than tax, you have to have a permit to buy firewood. Now, isn't that progress? You got wood, you got a wood stove. So in order to have wood for your wood stove, you have to get a permit that costs money. And then they allow you, how nice they are, to buy some firewood. And then you pay 25% sales tax on that. So if you really like socialism, that's the beautiful country to go to. It's a beautiful country. Now, don't get sick over there. Because if you get sick over there, if you got a problem, you have to contact the hospital. You cannot go to the nearest hospital. You are in regions. And you got to your region hospital, which might be 50 to 100 miles away. And you got to take a number. You got to get an appointment. So if you need surgery for a hernia, or you got a cataract and so on, it might be 6 months or a year before there's an opening for you to have surgery. That's socialized medicine. It's wonderful. And then they have what I call the death quarters. People in the hospitals, they deem, they're going to die anyway. They simply moved in. We call them here hospice. In Sweden, they have special units. And once you go there, you get no water, you get no food, and they guarantee you in 5 days you're dead. That's social medicine. It's better than the barrels they used to have when they stuck people in a barrel with nails inside and rolled them down the hill. So this is more humane. No water, no food for 5 days, and you are gone. Now, if you think that is too sophisticated, then go to Venezuela or go to Somalia. And it's a lovely time there. They want to speed up the process of socializing. They want a new world order, and they want the one world government. Let me mention this to you today that you will not find in the media in the United States. You know, everybody is supporting Israel. You got to support Israel. It's God's people, you know. Send your money. Go your support. Israel first, Israel first. Well, in Israel today, actually it was yesterday, but it was released the news today, and I got it straight from Jerusalem. We have a network here in the United States called God TV. It's a huge Christian network, and they are pro-Zionist, and they had applied for a permit in Israel to have a station there to have their programs. And they got permitted. They started up. But then the rabbi said, they are proselyting. They're talking about simply witnessing and bringing people to Christ. In Israel, it is a crime to speak to another Jew and say, I want to tell you about Jesus. That's a crime in Israel. You can't do that. So they put a plug on them. So today, God TV was notified, they had their headquarters in the United States, that you lost your license. You can't be here because you're proselyting. But, you know, we take your money and your support, but you can't talk about Jesus. I said that because I'm going to read to you from the Anti-Defamation League, ADL. It's not an organization I really like. They're very anti-Christian. But I was surprised that they actually had a better write-up on Antifa than some of the others that were supposed to be Christian outfits. And If you looked on page number 3, I just want to bring this out to a couple of things. Today's Antifa argue that they are on the ground defense against individuals that believe are promoting fascism in the United States. However, Antifa, who have many anti-police anarchists in their ranks, can also target law enforcement with both verbal and physical assaults because they believe the police are providing cover for the white supremacists. Now, who is the white supremacist according to them? I am one, you are one, because we believe in Jesus, we have been saved, we believe in law and order, we believe in the United States was founded, we believe in the Constitution. You're a white supremacist. While some of them use their fists, other violent tactics include throwing projectiles, including bricks, crowbars, homemade slingshots, metal chains, water bottles, and balloons filled with urine and feces. Now, the police, when they get out there and try to hold them off, how would you like to get a balloon filled with urine and feces and burst and it runs down your face? I mean, you know, they really not like to do some things. They have deployed noxious gases, pushed through police barricades, attempted to exploit and perceived weakness in law enforcement presence. And what's the cry? Defund the police. Get the police off. We don't need it. Now, in Minneapolis, they want to have a social force of men and women that bears no arms, but that will simply go in and talk to the criminals and say, Mr. Criminal, would you please stop burglarizing? Would you stop raping this woman here? We'd be nice to you. We're not going to arrest you. We're just going to talk to you. Now, they also do what they call doxing. Not all are simply lower-end people. You have some very intelligent people working here, and they go in and they find out the name and address of the police officer, judges, and people that they don't like pastors and so on, and they post information on the internet. This is where this guy lives. Go and get him, and so on. That's called doxing. Now let me turn to page number 4. And what should Christians do? Now I'm going to let you read by yourself the Antifa manual. It's self-explanatory. And I'm not going to spend time on that garbage, but you can read it for yourself. So what should we do? Well, turn with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 8. The Gospel of John, the 8th chapter. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 34. Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say to you, whosoever commits sin is a servant of sin. And the servant abides under the house forever, but the son abides ever. If the son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me, because my word has no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my father, and you do that which you have seen with your father." They answered and said unto him, "Abraham is our father." Jesus said unto them, "If you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man that told you the truth, which I've heard of God. This did not Abraham. You do the deeds of your father." They said to him, "We have been not born of fornication. We have one father, even God." Jesus said to them, "If God were your father, you would love me. For I proceed forth and come from God, neither came I of myself, but he that sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? even because you cannot hear my word. You are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, abundant in the truth, because there's no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he's a liar and the father of it. Now, I told you earlier in the message here that the people that are in the Democratic Party, there might be a few Christians there, but they are lukewarm Christians. They are demon-possessed. Their father is the devil. When you see Nadler, who is one of the people in the political leaders in the Congress, he's Jewish, he's a Kabbalist, and he's for abortion, he's for homosexuality, he's for homosexual marriages. Schumer is another Jewish Kabbalist. And I just saw today, when I read the news from Israel, I saw an ad in the Jewish publication. Remove Schumer. They don't like Schumer, because Schumer is not pro-Israel. So they're fighting within. Pelosi is a Catholic, but she has Jewish background on the other side. And these people, they are demon-possessed. They will do the bidding of their father, the devil. So we are fighting, not flesh and blood. It is not these people, but it's a spirit behind them. And that's what we had so vicious the moment President Trump was elected. You remember that? 2016. The moment he was elected, millionaires showed up and said, we're going to try to change the Electoral College. They wanted faithless people there that would vote against what the state had said they should vote for. Remember how they fought that? When he was inaugurated, we got the Russia collusion. Then we got the Ukraine. Then we got all the other things. It is hate. Now you got John Bolton. John Bolton got an axe to grind. And he's coming out now. He was praising President Trump. Now he's simply saying, I want to make sure that he doesn't get a second term. Who is John Bolton to tell the rest of us who we should have for a president? He's self-righteous. He's demon-possessed. He's one of those people that are out there. So now, as Christians, what can we do? Let me take it to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians, the 6th chapter. And I start in verse number 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. This is a battle. It's a spiritual battle. We are not wrestling against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the root of the darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Some of you might not understand that the spirit world is very real. In 2018, I'm doing my biography in 2018 right now. My wife, I had to take her to the hospital. I woke up one morning, and when I looked at Ina, I couldn't believe what I saw. She was bruised in the face. She had a big bruise on this arm. And on this arm, it was like somebody had taken a knife and carved a hole about the size of a quarter, almost all the way into the bone. I looked upon her. I said, "What happened?" She said, "I got attacked." She got beat up by evil spirits. So what I had to do, I put in the car, I drove to the ER, and I got in the wheelchair, put her up there, and I said, "You know, you got to do that. She cannot sit and wait. You got to take her right now." They looked at her and said, "Oh, you will take her right now." So they took her in and talked to her, and then they called me in. And the first question they asked me this, "Do you have any weapons at home?" I said, "What do you ask that?" "Well, it looks like you have hurt your wife." I said, "You're kidding. Do you have any weapons at home?" I said, "I'm not going to answer that question. It's none of your business if I have or not." Now, they viewed me very suspicious. And I tried to tell them, "Well, she got thrown around." "You don't tell them. There's a demon did that." I even showed her arm to people in this ministry a few days later. I showed her, like, "Look at this." They saw it. So it took about 5-6 weeks. We had to go to wound care after they cleaned her up. We had people come out, change to dress the wound every day, and it took a long time. So we decided this, we're going to do mini deliverance on her. And I think I had Henry and I had Sotiris did a mini deliverance on her, and we tried to cast it out. Demons are real, folks. And we're not going to fight these Democrats in the flesh. We got to fight them on our knees. And that takes me to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse number 3. "Whether we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imagination, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And having a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled." Here's what we need to do. You need to do that, I need to do that, and I do. Every day, we should pray and bind the spirits, the fallen angels over Washington, D.C., over the New York, where we got a financial district. We should simply bring down imagination, cast them down, take every thought captive, and pull down the strongholds. I'm going to be nice, but I'm going to say this to you. Most Christians are prayerless. I've found very few Christians that have a good prayer life. We work, we do a lot of things, but we don't pray. That's a problem. And Satan said, "You can read the Bible, you can play Christian music, you can go to church, but I don't want you to pray. Ask yourself this. Have you prayed according to this for the nation every day? Do you pray over your days? Do you have a time of prayer? I would say this, that most Christians, they have what they call a little nice food prayer. God bless the food. Thank you, God, we got food in Jesus' name. Amen. Eat. That's why we are weak. You have to take your position. It is not enough to vote in the election. You have to pray before the election. I told you there's 11 new voters come in. We need to pray that God will get a hold of them. It's not enough to have advertisement and television ads and so on. We need to reach the souls of the people. And only the Holy Spirit can do that. That's where your prayers and my prayer comes in. Let me read verse 4 again. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. We need to pull down Nancy Pelosi, Nadler, Schumer, and all the others. We need to pull them down. That's done in the spirit, not in the flesh. We need to pull down stuff at the Supreme Court. We need to have Ruth Bader Ginsburg gone and some of the others. Now, we're not called to kill people. We're called to save people. Turn to Matthew chapter 28. That's Matthew chapter 28. These are familiar verses. And Jesus came and spake to them, saying, all power is given to me in heaven and earth. Go you therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things, whatsoever I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Now, we are supposed to witness, to pray for people, to bring people to Christ. That is what we are called. When we come into the Antichrist system and people are taking the mark of the beast, they can't be saved. That's a different era. There'll be times we might have to kill some people. They're going to go to hell anyway. See, it doesn't make any difference, but we're not there now. So now we are not to kill people. Let me finish in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And I want to pick it up from verses 14 and 16. But the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritual discerned. But he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who has known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. The natural man, the unborn person, receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolish unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. I want to ask some personal questions right now. How many minutes do you pray every day? Do you pray 5 minutes? 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you know. I would say this, that most of you watching me and listening, you probably pray less than 3 minutes a day. You pray for the meal. That's it. Maybe you get pious on Sunday and you have a little bit longer prayer on Sunday. It's not going to cut the mustard. God needs every one of you every day to use the scriptures I gave in Ephesians and 2 Corinthians and say, God, I'm going to pray for Washington, D.C. now. I'm going to pull down the strongholds. I'm going to destroy the works of the devil. I'm going to bind up the demons. I'm going to pray for the governor in the state I live in. I'm going to pray for the people that are local in the county or cities. I mean, do you have anything between the ears? I'm upset. Because I can get people to read the Bible. I get people to read this or do this, but I can't get people to pray. It's like pulling teeth. And the question is, how will it take? How much do we have to suffer before we learn to pray? We got a little bit over 100 days left to the election in November this year. If you and I start today, I already started, but if you start today, some of you might already do it. But if you start today and saying this, okay, I'm going to memorize these two scriptures. I'm going to pull down the strongholds. I'm going to destroy the works of the devil. I'm going to ask God to move. I'm going to ask God to release his holy angels. I'm going to do some spiritual warfare. Maybe spend 10 minutes a day. It's going to make a vast difference on election day. But if you're lazy and you're prayerless, don't come to me and cry when you have Joe Biden sworn in. Don't come and cry. I'm going to say this. That's what you get for not praying. 78-year-old man with dementia. Can't even tell the difference between his wife and his sister. That's what you're going to get. Because we did not pray. I really want to emphasize that. Will you do it? I don't know. I work with people every day, trying to get people to pray. I might as well ask them to go and shoot themselves. And the reason is, there are evil spirits that simply tell you prayer is not important. You don't have time to pray. You got things to do. Yeah, if you don't pray, it doesn't matter what you do. You pray first, and then you really can do things. So that is how I'm going to close today. I love you, but I'm upset. I like you. I have many people writing to us and so on. But you cannot be prayerless. You've got to be part of the solution. You watch me right now, you says, I'm not even saved. I want to get in on this. I want to get saved. Here's what you do. Just begin to simply say this. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross for me. I believe that through him I can be saved, and I want to be saved. Jesus, come on in. Take my sins away. Forgive me. And he will do that. When we finish here, you're going to see a screen come up. Three crosses. You're going to hear Pastor Torell, Charles Torell, come up, my nephew. And he's going to say, my friend. And he's going to take you through the step of salvation. Follow him. Receive Christ today and be saved. Be part of the solution. And to those of you that are Christians, been watching us for years, would you do God a favor? Would you do me and you a favor? Would you simply say, Father God, forgive me for being prayerless. I'm going to change. I'm going to start praying. That is my prayer right now. And here is Brother Thomas.
Father God, thank you for this wonderful day today. We thank you for our many blessings, Lord. We thank you for the Word of God that is always good. It's eternal. It is a big blessing to mankind. And we thank you for discernment of the times that we are in. We thank you for those out there. I'm reminded of what was said to Elijah. I have 7,000 that haven't bowed the knee to Baal. They are out there. There are people engaged in the kingdom. And we thank you for that. We lift up this up-and-coming election in the United States. It's actually a global situation. Who becomes president of the United States, Lord? We thank you, Lord, that the Bible says that that you put them in place and that you move the heart of the king. So we thank you, Father God, for the knowledge to know that. We pray for the Christian and the non-Christian, those that are not born again, that they need to hear the gospel. The gospel is worldwide. They need to receive the gospel, have the ability to repent and be born again. And we pray for the believer to engage and not to be a spectator. We lift up the weak, 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 weak Christian pastors in America that are down on their knees and around the world, that you would give them a backbone. And we lift up these seminaries that are full of communists and liars, and that you would root them out. We thank you, Father God, for the Word of God. It's always the Word of God that's going to take you through. We thank you for these many wonderful blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all 3 questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these 3 questions are but 3 of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are 3 places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of 2 places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the third part in the series, America in Turmoil, and was entitled, Order Out of Chaos. America is now at the tipping point that the next president could voluntarily surrender our sovereignty to Satan's global federation. Antifa is a loose collection of individuals who claim to be anti-fascist. They are strikingly similar to the communist and Nazi thugs of the past for their aggressive opposition to anyone they consider dangerous. They decry white privilege and national borders, wanting to socialize capital, control the media, and establish a new world order. Their idea of tolerance is that you need to line up with them or face the consequences. The political stage is set, and civil unrest is being orchestrated to destabilize our nation. The solution is not to take up arms and fight these people. We need to win them for Christ instead. This is a battle that must be fought with spiritual weapons. Only through the power of the Holy Spirit can we convince people to stand for biblical principles and cast their votes for candidates who are willing to uphold the teachings of Jesus. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1762. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.